I would like to hand the conference over to Mr. Yogesh Agrawal, Managing Director of Ajanta Pharma Limited. Thank you, and over to you, sir.
Thank you. Good evening and welcome to all of you. With me, I have Mr. Rajesh Agrawal, our Joint Managing Director, and Mr. Arvind Agrawal, our CFO. We sincerely hope that all of you are safe and healthy and taking abundant precautions against the second wave of the pandemic. Financial year 2021 saw the full impact of COVID-19 on life and business we could have never imagined. As we remained persistent to grow, we quickly adapted to new normal for working and ensured that we service all our customers globally without any interruptions or shortages in the supply. This has enabled us to achieve once again a remarkable performance in a very difficult year. Coming to the results, they are already with you now, and I'm happy to share that this has been an exciting quarter and the financial year. We have been able to achieve continued growth for the financial year 2021 in all markets we are present in, and also a stellar growth in the profit. With these opening remarks, I will now hand over to Arvind to take you through to the financials, and thereafter we'll open up the floor for question and answers. Thank you, and over to you, Arvind.
Thank you. Good evening to all of you, and a warm welcome for this earnings call. For ease of discussion, we will look at the consolidated financials. Let me discuss key financial highlights with you. It was indeed a satisfying performance for Q4, with 11% growth in revenue for the quarter. Branded generic sales in India grew 23%, whereas emerging markets saw a degrowth of 10%. US sales grew 20%, and institutional sales growth was 88%. Our performance for the year has been impressive, with revenue from operations up 12% at 2,890 crores. Branded generic contributed 68%, India was 28%, and emerging market was 40%. US has contributed 22%, and institutions has contributed 10%. Our gross margins have improved and stood at 78% against 75% in financial year 2020. This was mainly driven by product mix and impact of product recall in FY 2020. Other expenses saw sharp decline in H1 in FY 2021 due to lockdown, but we are normalized in the second half of the year. EBITDA stood at 34% for the quarter at rupees 259 crores, and profit after tax stood at rupees 159 crores. For the year, EBITDA stood at 35% or rupees 999 crores, with some contribution of saving in other expenses in H1, which is not sustainable. Profit after tax was 654 crores, up 40%. We incurred the capex of rupees 155 crores during the year. Return on net worth has moved up to 23% from 19% last year, and return on capital employed has moved up to 30% from 26% last year, as the return on our investment in new plants have started realizing. Our balance sheet continues to be healthy, with cash and liquid investment of more than 375 crores even after paying rupees 250 crores to the shareholders. With this analysis highlight, I open the floor for the question answer. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Ladies and gentlemen, we will now begin the question and answer session. Anyone who wishes to ask a question may press star and one on their touchtone telephone. If you wish to remove yourself from the question queue, you may press star and two. Participants are requested to use handset while asking a question. Ladies and gentlemen, we will wait for a moment while the question queue is handled. The first question is from the line of Rashmi Sancheti from InCred Research. Please go ahead.
Yeah, thank you for the opportunity. Sir, just want to know that are you seeing any sort of supply disruption in your Asia and Africa branded business? I mean, what is the reason for the degrowth during the quarter? And Secondly, if you can give the breakup, I mean, I know that we have changed the sales format, but since we already have 9 months numbers, if you can give one last quarter number of, you know, Asia and Africa business, the branded sales.
Yeah, so rightly said, we are seeing some disruptions in our market in the Asia and Africa. We believe they will stabilize soon. There is nothing which is a cause of concern. And that is the reason you've seen the dip in the current quarter. And also because of the corresponding quarter of the last year, we had seen slightly elevated numbers in exports for both these markets. So that's why the difference is coming slightly higher. The Asia for the quarter has been at 176 CR and the Africa branded has been at 97 CR. So we've seen a slight more dip in Asia as compared to Africa. Africa we still posted 3% growth and Asia is down by about 16%.
Okay, sir, and how do we see going ahead in FY22? I mean, are you finding it little tough in the coming quarters also due to the second wave of COVID surge?
There could be some disruption, but we don't anticipate this to be long-lasting. So we believe it should normalize going forward.
Okay, sir. And my second question is related to India market. Sir, are we seeing any field activity impacting again in this quarter because of the lockdown in some of the states? And related to your ophthalmology segment, you know, as a segment only, this particular therapy is not going. So is it temporarily due to COVID or the overall segment is seeing a last slowdown due to the, you know, lack of launches and all?
I will answer the second part of your question first. This is Rajesh Agrawal. In ophthalmology, I believe that this is only transitory, primarily because, again, Q4, the basic surgeries were down and OPDs were started to getting affected starting from March. So we are very hopeful that that should normalize going forward in this current year. And as far as the, the first part of your question was?
So related to field activity.
Absolutely. So in the field activity, what we have done is there are multiple states which are working from home. And safety of our employees will come at the topmost priority for us. And hence, we have, starting from mid of March, depending on whichever state is seeing the peak and the surge, we are putting our field force on work from home. But they are continuing to have a very strong customer connect through various means and various technology that we have deployed in the last year.
Okay, sir. So that means the operating cost will more or less, this is the new base, what we have reported in quarter four?
Yes, please. That is going to be the new normal and it may go up slightly as we go along in the year.
Okay, sir. Thank you. That's it from my side. I have no question. I'll get back in the queue.
Thank you.
Thank you. Before we take the next question, a reminder to the participants, please limit your question to two per participant. You may come back in the question queue if you have a follow-up. The next question is from the line of Tushar Manudhane from Motilal Oswal Financial Services. Please go ahead.
So just on the U.S. generic side, while the filing pace has been slower in FY21, and at the same time, the pandemic situation still continuing, maybe another 3 to 6 months. So the filing would be more back-ended or we will see this spread across the quarters for FY22?
As you know, last year it was a very hard lockdown. So because of that, the R&D was off for 5 months. And that is the reason we see those reflecting in the ANDA filing for the current year, or rather last year. But we believe we've made good progress during last 5-6 months. And currently also our R&D is operating, if not at a full capacity, but at a reasonably good capacity. So we believe that our R&D, the ANDA filings will pick up in the current year. And we should try, we'll try to come as close to the target of 10 to 12 per year.
And in the India business, how much would be the institutional sales for the quarter?
For the quarter, institutional sales is, give me a second, 21 crores.
that helps. And just lastly, in terms of, you know, while you did clarify on the outlook for the Asia and Africa branded generic piece, even there...
Request
you
speak a bit louder, your audio is not audible.
Yeah, so while you have given some color on the branded generics outlook in Asia and Africa, but on the similar lines, even there also you see the operating cost getting curtailed or reduced because of this lockdown related impact?
No, there is no lockdown similar to what we see in India there. So there it should be in the normal trend what we have seen in the past quarter.
Understood. So basically sales outlook also should be better than at least the industry and subsequently on the cost side as well.
Absolutely. The endeavor is to outgrow the market. So whatever is the market growth, our aim is to grow faster than the market.
All right, sir. Thanks. That helps. Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Omkar Kunkarde from Shree Consultancy. Please go ahead.
Hello. My question was regarding what kind of capex is lined up for the next 1 or 2 years, and what would be the asset turnover ratio in the past, the year which went by, and what would be the asset turnover ratio in the future you are looking at? Thank you.
So the last year capex was around 150 crore. In the early part of the year, there was a lockdown. In the year, current year, we are estimating the capex to be in the vicinity of 250 crore. And what was the next question you had?
I was asking about the asset turnover ratio.
So I think the asset turnover ratio would be around in the vicinity of 1:1.75, about there. And it should probably improve from here onwards going forward.
Okay, and what was your, or what is currently the gross block in total?
Sorry, come again?
Gross block.
The gross block?
Gross block, I'm asking.
Gross block, 1 minute.
So around 1,800 crores.
1,800 crore.
Yeah, approximately, round about. Yeah. I think to be precise, 1,765.
Okay, this is gross, right, or net? Gross.
Yeah, gross.
So, and in that you are expecting around more than 1.75 asset turn, right?
No, we are talking on the net.
You're talking about 1.75 upwards and 1.75 on net. Right?
Yes, net fixed asset, yeah.
I'm talking about what is the ratio for the last year.
Sorry, can you please say that again?
This ratio, which 1.75, is net fixed asset turnover ratio for 2021, FY 2021.
Correct.
Yeah.
Okay, and the capex, which you talked about around 250 CF in the current fiscal, can you give just breakup of that? What would we go to?
It is largely going to be towards the maintenance capex and some new expansions for the corporate office and maybe some key expansions in the facility.
So no major expansion in terms of new capacity or something like that?
Capacity is no significant expansion. We believe that we have enough capacities right now to cater to our growth.
So what is the current utilization rate you are working on?
It's very difficult to give you a utilization right now because of the current challenges of the pandemic. It is currently fluctuating, but we have sufficient capacities right now.
Okay, so there is no need to put up anything extra?
No, there is no need to put anything extra right now.
Okay, all right. Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you. Before we take the next question, a reminder to the participants again, please limit your question to 2 per participant only. You may rejoin the question queue if you have a follow-up. The next question is from the line of Manoj Garg from White Oak Capital. Please go ahead.
Yeah, good evening to all of you, and congratulations for putting a very strong set of numbers. in challenging times like this. And happy to see, sir, that at least now you have started this quarterly phone call, and hope this will become a regular phenomena going forward. So just coming to the first question, and that's largely on the domestic market, what we have seen a good recovery on the dump side, dermatology, which were pulling obviously our performance over the past, one and a half years. So if you can just highlight the kind of initiative which we have taken, and that has helped us to bring back the growth in this segment particularly.
So we have initiated multiple customer relationship management initiatives that we took in the last year on a cluster basis. We have four teams in dermatology, and all four teams put together, we initiated the outreach where we held lots and lots of webinars with the customers. We held many roundtable meetings and doctor group meetings. And we enrolled a whole lot of the PG graduates into medical training and all of that. So those are the efforts that we took, which has helped us to turn around in the last year. Plus, honestly speaking, opening up of the market in Q3 and Q4 also helped us a lot, along with the industry. As you would remember, dermatology got the most hit because derma being more of a lifestyle in the first two quarters of last year. So we saw some recovery happening in quarter four.
Understood. And the second question is basically, while I understand over the past 3-4 years, the focus was to build capacity, and we obviously have invested quite a bit in terms of creating infrastructure, creating plants and all. But given the kind of profitability and the return metrics we enjoy, how should we think about reinvesting a part of profit to further accelerate the growth momentums, particularly branded markets like India, emerging market, and even in the US? If you can just throw some light out there.
So I think we've discussed this in the past or so. So there has been no holdback in the growth because of the want of the funds. The balance sheet, we've been fairly profitable, and healthy cash balance has been there. So I don't think it's the right way to connect cash flow or cash balance with the growth. They are irrespectively happening. So whatever is the requirement of the market in terms of field expansion, new product launches, R&D spend, and contribution of all these 3-4 things results into the growth. When you add more people, more product, and existing people will start giving more higher return. So all the 3-4 aspects are going on independently. So I hope I'm able to kind of give you answer which you're looking for.
So the only thing, Yogesh, and sorry, I'm extending this question. That today, if you look at the size and scale where we are, and obviously like the focus has always been on the profitable growth.
But
given the kind of potential opportunities market has, I clearly see that we do have a case in terms of accelerating the growth number, which we are putting up over the last 2-3 years in terms of, early double-digit kind of range to maybe mid to high teens kind of things. And that is what probably I was just trying to understand, that are we thinking about maybe getting into newer markets, seeding newer markets, or maybe within India, maybe expanding our therapy base, given that we are still like 100 billion plus kind of franchise in India as of now.
The effort is constantly on both the aspects, A, to evaluate newer markets, and B, to penetrate those markets even further, whether it is India or international markets where we are present. Even within India, you rightly pointed out, we are still continuing to dig deeper into the four specialties that we are present. But at the same time, we keep evaluating all the opportunities that we may get for a brand or a company acquisition, to really see if we can expand the footprint. Having said that, the current markets across the globe and within India, the specialties that we are in, offer us enough opportunity to continue to grow. And as you rightly pointed out, profitable growth is, I think, of prime most importance for us. So we continue the efforts towards it.
Sure. Thank you very much for answering all the questions, and I wish you all the best, sir.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Runjun Jain from Nirmal Bang. Please go ahead.
Thank you for taking my question. Congratulations to the management for good set of numbers and for keeping the con call. Sir, I just want to know, most of the questions have been answered.
But requesting you to please speak a bit louder, ma'am.
Okay. Is it a little better?
Yes. Thank you so much.
Thank you. So, though most of the questions have been answered, sir, I just want to know and understand what is the thing differently we are doing in pain management. So, we have seen during the quarter that the industry growth has been negative, whereas we have reported a good growth in the pain management. And overall, we have seen that the acute segment has been under pressure. So, what is something we are doing differently here, and is it sustainable?
I hope it is sustainable. The difference that we have brought is, again, what we have been doing for the last 15 years. We introduced some very good products in FY20, which have yielded positive results in the last year, FY21, and which are growing robustly. We are ahead of the competitors for the likes of biggest competitors in the rheumatoid arthritic segment. So those brands are the ones that are really driving the growth, along with our lead brand, Feburic, which is the second largest brand of febuxostat in the country. And even at a 50 crore rupee sales, that is growing in early teens kind of growth rate. And we are quite confident that this growth rate should, this momentum should continue with all the effort that we are putting into this segment.
Great to hear, sir. Sir, last question is, is it possible for the management to quantify the savings and the other expenses due to lower field activity, if it is any, and when it is likely to, you know, I mean, how much that impact would be on the margins?
As far as the saving in expenses is concerned, it was there in first quarter and second quarter, but then now it has got normalized, and now the expenses are absolutely normal for all field expenses also and R&D expenses also.
So the Q4 other expenses is the current base?
That's right.
Yes.
Thank you. Thank you very much and all the best.
Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Abdul from Anandati. Please go ahead.
Yeah, hi, sir. Thank you for this opportunity. So my first question is regarding the India business. And what you mentioned on the pain side, that there were a couple of launches which helped you in FY21. So going forward, how many launches should we expect in FY22? And you know, how many of those could be the first two market products? And in which therapeutic segment, you know, the focus would be now?
So going forward, in the current year, we are working on multiple opportunities. Unfortunately, I'll not be able to put a number to that. As a matter of policy, we don't give the guidance on the new brand launches that we intend to do. But we have exciting opportunities that have been lined up. And we are very hopeful that at least for both of them, we could be number one. If not, we will be number two for sure. And and in the past year, the brands that we have launched will again continue to deliver in the current year also. As you would know, in pharma, it would take typically between 4 to 6 years for the brand, if nurtured well, to really peak on the sales side. So we are quite hopeful that in the next 2 years, again, we'll continue to build on that.
Sure. And my second question is with regards to manage, to the margins, and this is in continuation with the previous speaker. So when we said that the other expenses and the other related costs are back to the previous level or, you know, fully recovered, are we indicating this 34% sort of EBITDA margin would be sustainable for next year?
Not really. I think, as you know very clearly, that the first half was beneficial for us. So naturally, that impact is there. So I don't think it will get normalized in next year.
Okay. So would you like to quantify any number to which, you know, the margins could vary around for next year?
I don't think we'll be able to give out a number as such, but I think whatever we were doing it earlier, I think we should get normalized to that level.
Sure, sir. Understood. Thank you for answering my questions.
Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Kunal Randeria from Edelweiss. Please go ahead.
Good evening, everyone. So my first question is actually an extension of the previous participant's question. In the next 3 to 4 years, are you seeing sort of enough opportunities in the first two market molecules, and any particular segment you think is very attractive and you would like to highlight?
Sure. You know, it's a very kind of a melting pot situation. The opportunities keep presenting and unfolding, even though we work on them for 6 years, 7 years to get the regulatory approval. But so we are working on multiple opportunities, which could be first to market in this year as well as in the coming 3 to 4 years also. And I would not like to quantify it because it will be premature to do that. And we are fairly sure that those will be the growth drivers for us.
But any input, I mean, are you seeing it across all your four therapies, or it's a bit more concentrated?
More or less, yes. We have been able to, in the past year, if we talk about, we've been able to launch two new molecules for the first time in the country in ophthalmology, which were both for anti-glaucoma. In the last quarter itself, we launched another new product for the first time in the country, which was for severe dry eyes and corneal abrasion. Including in cardiology, we were able to innovate and launch for the first time in the country azelindipine. So we have had interesting launches, and so it was in dermatology. We are able to innovate across segments, and we hope that we will be able to continue that.
Okay, sure. So my second question is on the U.S. business. Now, you did mention the number of filings that you expect to make, but can you also share expected launches? And also, see, because a lot of other pharma companies are targeting like 15 to 20 launches annually, so I'm just wondering why you not being a bit more aggressive. So are there not enough lucrative opportunities? Will growth then come at the cost of profit, and hence you're going a bit slow in the U.S.?
Whatever we've been filing, we are in fact very efficiently getting the approvals for the ANDAs. So as and when the ANDAs are getting approved, we are getting the products to the market. There is no issue on that front. Only I think last year our filing was impacted because of the pandemic. Otherwise, we've been fairly consistent in filing as well as launching the products in U.S. So we earlier, some of the companies, they may be having the filings in the excess of 20, 30, and that's how then they get the approach in those numbers. We've never been in that race. So our focus was always to be very calibrated in the kind of investments which we make on the ANDA. And that is the reason whatever we've been filing, we've been able to commercialize those.
Sure. So maybe in the next couple of years, you'll be targeting maybe like 8 to 10 launches every year.
Right now, we are giving out the guidance of 10 to 12 filings, and correspondingly, they should be able to, you know, fructify and come to the market.
Sure. And just one quick clarification. So in your presentation, I just saw that you have like a 300-plus product basket in India. And if I see the last quarter's presentation, it was some 270-plus. So have you sort of made 20, 25 launches in this quarter?
We have had 21 new brand launches in the last whole year, of which 5 products were for the first time in the country across different therapeutic segments. So this is the figure that we had.
Right. And maybe for FY22, any kind of guidance would you like to give us?
I would not like to put a number to it. The efforts are on to continue to innovate because the market opportunities also depend how the COVID situation also unfolds. We will have to keep that also in consideration.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you very much, and all the best.
Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Elroy Lobo from Kotak Investment. Please go ahead.
Yeah. Thanks for taking my question. One is on your recent investment in ABCD Technologies of around 25 crores for a 4% stake. Could you just, you know, give us some perspective, you know, on why you made this investment? Number one. Number two, on your CapEx of 250 crores, how much of it is allocated for corporate office expansion?
Well, I'll take the first part of the question on the ABCD technology. So effectively, somewhere between 15 and 20 Indian large size Indian pharma companies have come together, and in an effort to streamline the logistics that we have in the country so that we can bring in more efficiency. At the same time, we can have cost saving at the end of, for example, the product expiries and the sales return that we have, as well as we want to enable the pharmacies and the stockists to be able to have a better visibility on the products that they should be stocking based on their sales strengths. And hence we've joined hands, and we hope to be able to bring this efficiency into the supply chain in the country. And with ABCD, we should be able to do that. So that's the intent.
And regarding the capex for the corporate office, last year it was about 30 crores, and current year it could be in the vicinity of 60 to 80 crores.
Okay. Coming to the MR productivity, could you just give us how that has moved in FY21 with respect to FY20, and where do you see it, you know, finally getting optimized at?
You know, I would like to break it down into each segment, because our segments are kind of extreme. So for that matter, in ophthalmology, if I look at, in ophthalmology, we are at an optimum MR productivity level. If you compare us with the number one and number three competitor, we are nearly there. So our productivity is not less, but in ophthal alone, you cannot expect a productivity of 10 lakhs to 12 lakhs, because the segment being a small segment. If you look at cardiology, we have four teams, and of those, two teams are already touching a productivity of somewhere between 5 lakhs to 6 lakhs. And it's the other two teams that are rapidly growing, and we hope to catch up in the current year. Dermatology, as you all know, is an area where we faced multiple challenges in the last 2 years. But we are rapidly improving on that. And the team sizes are much smaller in derma, because a couple of teams focus purely on the lifestyle as well as the cosmetology part of it. So we are quite hopeful that in the current year, the productivity should improve, and we should get a growth in that.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Bonald Kansin from Value Taker Analysis. Please go ahead.
Hello. Are you able to hear me,
sir? Yes, we can hear you.
So my first question is on the outsourcing front. I believe with the Dahej, Guwahati facility, the India formulation outsourcing are they aiming to bring it down substantially. So what kind of outsourcing will still be left post that? And the question related to this is that, as I understood earlier, the smart outsourcing done by you was a major source of margin advantage that Ajanta enjoyed. And how would that picture change now with reduced outsourcing?
Your question was not quite audible. The way I understood is that you are looking at what kind of domestic production we have shifted to the Guwahati facility. Is it correct?
Outsourcing, sir. What portion of outsourcing that was done earlier?
So outsourcing, a good part of was being outsourced earlier. And now in the last year, we have transitioned a very good big part of that to our Guwahati facility for all the dosage forms for the domestic. So it will be a small percentage in the current year, which will be still outsourced.
How is the margin picture going to look, sir, with this outsourcing margin?
So margin, you've already seen that in the current year, in the current quarter, that is factoring in the transition also. So it should not change much from there. Naturally, the in-house cost will be higher than what we were sourcing outside. But for the want of better control on our own production and supply chain, we have consciously taken that decision. So at the same time, we'll see some efficiency in the income tax also, because that still that unit being an income tax exempted. So there'll be set off of some income tax benefit against expenses that will happen.
Right, sir. Can I ask another question, sir?
Yeah, go ahead.
Okay. Sir, just wanted to understand a little bit more
from how the organization has, in the U.S. market especially, you have done extremely well in the last 4 to 5 years. At the same time, we have seen that generics, big pharma like Mylan, Teva, Sandoz, all of them have been losing market share. And some other Indian companies like Alembic, Torrent, Alkem, they have been gaining market share. So what's your view for the next 3 to 5 years? How do you see the competitive environment and the margin profile? And if you could elaborate, how have you organized your sales, distribution, and warehousing operations in the U.S. to give us a flavor of how you're executing there?
What we have seen 2-3 years back, due to the customer consolidation, there was a huge margin pressure in the U.S. We are seeing that that has stabilized now. Having said that, it is very difficult to put what kind of price erosions that can happen for a particular product or in a particular quarter. But nevertheless, it is stabilized much better as compared to what we had seen a few years back. Going forward, we believe the competitive intensity was there 5 years, 10 years back also, and it will remain 5 years, 10 years later also. There should not be any change. How the organization or the strategizes its thing in the market or with the product portfolio, supply chain, and all the other things, compliance with the facility, I think that will determine what kind of market share we are able to get and then sustain. So far we've been able to execute quite well on all the aspects in compliance, in terms of facilities, supply chain. So we feel comfortable to carve out the space for ourselves going forward in the U.S. market.
Any flavor you would like to give about how your sales organization is there in the U.S.? What kind of team and what kind of experience is there?
It's a too granular discussion which cannot be held on the con call. Every organization has their own setup. So we have a fairly good team which is doing a great job there.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right, sir. Thank you, and I'll get back to the queue.
Sure.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Anupam Agarwal from Lucky Investment. Please go ahead.
Good evening, sir, and congratulations on great set of numbers. Sir, just to start with, if you can give some color on the African institutional business, it's been a fairly lumpy sale quarter on quarter and over the last year. Can you give some highlights and color of what this business is going to shape out for the next 2 years?
It's one of those very difficult businesses to predict because that depends on number of factors on what is the funds available with the NGOs and the global fund. This whole year, I think we've been able to do better. We've posted 11% growth. Going forward, our outlook would be to maintain the similar level of sales. That's all I can say.
Understood. So second question, coming to US, we've not launched any product in this quarter. And so basically, can you quantify on the number of launches that we intend to do next year?
I don't have the number what we'll be able to launch next year, because that's also dependent on the FDA. And as you know, right now, currently with the inspections not happening, the approvals are getting delayed significantly. But we are keeping a close watch and close contact with the FDA to see if we are able to facilitate some approvals of the product. And resultant to that, we'll get the product in the market.
Right. Sir, in the past, there have been certain hints and guidance coming from the management on growing U.S. business at 25% CAGR for the three years. Do we still stand by that number? Or?
Sorry, come again?
In the past, sir, we've been hinted by the management that U.S. business is going to grow at 25% CAGR. Do we still stand by that number?
We've been giving the guidances earlier, but as a policy, going forward, I think we will not like to give the guidances. More so in the current pandemic situation, it's very difficult to give any kind of predictions.
So last question on the R&D, what would be the percentage range that we look to spend on R&D going ahead?
It should increase from current 5%. It could go above 6%.
And can you give a mix between how much we would spend on US in that?
The spend between the US and the non-US.
Mm-hmm.
I don't have the specific number right now. Maybe we'll come back to you on that.
Understood. Thank you and all the best, sir.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Mitesh Shah from ICICI Securities. Please go ahead.
Thanks for taking my question and congratulations for the good sets of numbers. Can you see any of the impact of this second wave in your business, like the export or the domestic market?
On the domestic front, none of our brands are actually affected positively by COVID. So we are not getting any tailwinds because we are not present in the typical segments of, let's say, for example, the azithromycins or the paracetamols or the vitamin C and vitamin D and all of those. So it's quite neutral to us. We are not getting any positive tailwinds from that.
And the about the export market also, even the same?
Yeah, exports, we have a azithromycin brand for the export market, and we've seen last year the uptake in that particular product. But if you see in the overall scheme of 2018 growth, it will not be such a significant percentage.
Can I get the segment-wise bifurcation of domestic branded business for Q4?
We don't give that segment-wise. What we have given you is the IMS number. That is something which has already been given to you.
Okay. Thanks a lot. That is from my end.
Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Nimesh Mehta from Research Delta Advisors. Please go ahead.
Yeah, thanks for the opportunity and congrats for a good set of numbers. One question on the domestic, you mentioned that you launched 5 products which are first to market. If you can just let us know in which segment you have launched this, that will be helpful.
Sure. 2 have been in cardiology and 2 of them have been in ophthalmology. And the 5th one has been in pain segment.
Pain. And these are not line extensions, right? These are completely new product.
These are completely new brands. One was Vildagliptin sustained release, where the conventional release was already available, but we were the first brand in the country to launch a 100 milligram sustained release, which offers superior patient compliance over the existing conventional dosage form. So that I would like to categorize as a new brand, not a line extension.
Right. Okay. So
including that, we have 5 new brands.
Okay. Interesting. Great. The other question I had was on the US business. We see quite a few interesting products which are lined up. One is, the brand name Vimovo or Naproxen Esomeprazole Magnesium, where we have a Para-4. And second is the Varnacilin Tartrate. So can you let us know, what is the likely timeline and are they interesting products or am I missing something?
Definitely, they both are the interesting product and they are at an advanced stage of the review with the FDA. Very difficult to predict the approval timeline from the FDA.
I think both of them have been settled. So you would know other than the approval, if a ballpark number, a ballpark timeline can be given, that will be helpful. Assuming the approval will come, in, let's say, next 2 quarters.
No, I wish I could give either of the things. Both are not in my hand. So right now, I don't know the approval timeline for either of the products.
I was talking about the settlement-related timelines. Approval, obviously, we will not know. But based on the settlement, can we launch in this year, let's say in FY22?
I don't have that information with me right now.
Okay. And lastly, we also see a lot of products that you are developing for the U.S. market in the ophthalmology segment. Is that true? And if yes, is that going to be a next focus area for us for the U.S. generics?
That is on the drawing board for the evaluation, but no concrete decision has been taken to go ahead with the filing in the ophthalmic space yet.
Okay, okay, fine. Thank you very much.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Manish Dhariwal from Fiducia Capital. Please go ahead.
Yeah, thank you for this opportunity. Yeah, my question was basically on the balance sheet. I noted that the inventory levels have increased, whereas the receivables have actually had some very good control, in fact, have come down. So if you could give some perspective on that.
See, as far as inventories are concerned, this is a conscious call taken by the management to ensure that we don't get any disruption because of the current situation of pandemic. So we hope that this is something which will help us to maintain our supplies absolutely without any interruption into any of the markets. So this is a conscious decision which has been taken. As far as receivables are concerned, yes, we have been able to improve, and this is definitely on the back of some improvement in our US collections, and this is something which can be sustained.
Oh, that's wonderful. That's wonderful. So this inventory, I understand that this is more on the API side rather than on the finished goods side.
It is mix of it. It is mix.
Okay. Thank you so much. Thank you.
The next question is from the line of Omkar Gunkarde from Shree Consultancy. Please go ahead.
I just wanted to know what is the management's vision for, say, in terms of revenue and profit growth for the next 3 to 5 years. What's your vision?
Profit growth.
I'm sorry, not able to give any guidance on those.
No, I'm not expecting any guidance from you. Just a trajectory I'm looking at. I'm not expecting any numbers from you.
So the trajectory, as I shared before, our endeavor is to grow faster than the market and the segments in which we operate in. So we are quite confident to outpace the market and keep growing.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Nitin Agarwal from DAM Capital. Please go ahead.
Hi, thanks for taking my question. Sir, on the emerging market businesses, especially in Asia and in Africa, the strategy there essentially for is going to be growth in the current key markets, or it's going to be more about, are you looking to enter new markets to primarily grow the segment over the next 3 to 5 year period?
So broadly, it is going to be in the existing markets. We believe that we have enough head space for us to be able to keep growing there in the same markets.
Have you seen any competitive changes in these markets? For good or for bad, in terms of which has made them the attractiveness of the market change in any ways since the time you've been there? You've been there in these markets for a pretty long time now.
No significant change which stands out, which is worth discussing. The normal pharma challenges which are there, they continue.
Right. And in terms of our therapy presence, what are there any specific therapies that we are especially strong in these markets?
It is very market specific. So, for example, in the Philippines, we are very strong in pulmonology, antidiabetic, respiratory. So it's very market specific. We try and identify the opportunities that market presents, and then fill the unmet needs by way of launching new brands.
Okay. And so, secondly, this year, through the year, we witnessed pretty strong improvement in gross margins in the business. The business mix doesn't seem to have changed much. So what really has driven that?
See, last year, if you understand, you remember, there was a product recall of US, because of which it got impacted. So now it is getting normalized for the year.
So these current level of these gross margins that we've done for this year are largely sustainable around these levels?
Going forward, we are not giving very specific, but I think it will increase because looking at the current situation in terms of the increasing API prices, etc., we expect we should be in the range of 35% gross margin.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Bharat Shah from ASK Investment. Please go ahead.
Hi, Yogesh and Rajesh. No real question to ask, but just to express that in a year which has been difficult with so many variables up in the air in so many geographies, this has been a really, really remarkable performance. So, hearty congratulations to you and the team. And Namaskar, Darwinji.
Namaskar, sir. Namaskar. Thank you very much.
Many thanks, Bharat, for your encouragement.
Thank you.
Thank you, Bharat. Thank you.
The next question is from the line of Gagan Talreja from Kotak Securities. Please go ahead.
Yeah, good evening. Am I audible?
Hopefully, sir.
Sir, requesting you to speak a bit louder.
Yeah, am I audible now?
Yes, you are.
Yeah, so first question is, around the commentary for drop in Asia sales, if you could elaborate what was the disruption which caused the drop in Asia sales for the quarter?
So it's a normal pandemic disruption. Some markets are having challenges to import, some clearance, supplies related issues, which are, we feel, transient and temporary.
Is it a logistics related issue or is it a market related issue?
No, mostly it is a logistics related issue. To an extent, like even the getting containers is sometimes become challenging, which we believe should get normalized.
And the tax rate in the quarter was also on the higher side. Given that you are going to grow production in your capacities which are in tax-free zones, how should we think of the tax rate going ahead?
Yeah, it should improve, certainly. I think as we go more and more into these capacities, there will be some improvement in the tax rate.
Any number you could, give as ballpark for the next 2 years, maybe?
It's very difficult because, it will depend on many factors. So, very difficult to give the number, but I think definitely you can see the improvement.
Okay. And in the past investor forums, you've generally been indicating that CAPEX will drop off after FY21. And I think the number generally given out was it would be more around 100 to 120, 125 crores. Whereas now you're guiding again for a 250 crore CAPEX next year. I would just like to understand what's the reason behind that. Steep uptick in CAPEX. I can understand some bit of it could be because this year was below your overall initial budget maybe, but it would still be significantly higher than past guidance.
So now the CAPEX has shifted from the new capacity to the maintenance CAPEX for the existing facilities. And for the current year, has given the guidance of approximately 200 CR. So a part of it will be going towards the new corporate office also.
Thereafter, what should the CAPEX be? Because you have adequate capacity and you would probably require only maintenance CAPEX. So thereafter, what could be the CAPEX trajectory or CAPEX budget like?
Should remain in the same vicinity of 150 CR to 200 CR.
Okay. And on margins, I'm a bit confused. On the one hand, you've indicated that the current quarter costs are representative of what costs will be in the future. Whereas I think there was also an indication that, some bit of the costs are this year were lower in an unsustainable way, and therefore there will be some drop. And also an indication that, they might go back to what they were in the past year. So which is it? I mean, is it that costs, that operating margins will be lower than the bygone year, but maybe in between 20 and 21, or probably closer to 20?
I think what you're talking about is...
What do you
Q1, Q2. So what we've been talking is that Q1, Q2 expenses, they have been depressed, and whereas Q3, Q4, they have normalized.
Yeah.
So that is what we are talking about.
So the Q3, Q4 margin run rate is a sustainable one?
To some extent, yes. But then again, I think the pickup in the R&D cost is going to be there. So it is going to be a little lower than what we have seen in these two quarters.
You're going to increase R&D by a percentage point, and that will impact the margin to that degree.
Yeah, exactly. Because filings have not been done in the these two quarters so far, which will pick up in the next year.
And on gross margins, I couldn't catch the number. You indicated this year's gross margins were better because last year there was a product recall in US which impacted gross margins. And going ahead, there might be an impact of API cost on gross margins, like if I caught it correctly.
Absolutely right.
So 75 is what you're saying for gross margins?
Yeah, plus minus 1 or 2%.
Okay, plus minus 1 or 2%.
Yeah.
Thank you, sir. And finally, sir, just on your working capital, you indicated that receivables which you closed this year are sustainable going ahead.
Yes.
Okay. Thank you, sir. That's all from me, sir.
Thank you.
The next question is from the line of Harsh Beria, individual investor. Please go ahead.
I would like to ask about your API sourcing strategy for the US formulations business. And this is because I don't see a lot of active DMFs from Ajanta. And do you have plans to do backward integration for US APIs?
No, we have no plans for the backward integration. And we have very good and strong partnerships with various API vendors with whom we are working. So we would like to continue excelling into the formulations, which is our core competence, and develop the products and keep filing.
Okay. And the next question would be, on just like a broad brush, revenue potential in a 5-year time frame. So I don't want a guidance from you, but currently you're doing around $80-85 million in US with your current strategy on oral solids. With this R&D spend, where do you see this number going? Can it be $200 million in a 5-7 year time frame? And do you have to go into other sterile projects to achieve that, or can that be done with oral solids itself?
It's a very long duration to talk about. I think we can talk of current year or next year. Directionally, or we believe that US market, if you play a right strategy, there is a business to be done and money to be made. In what shape or form it is going to be seen. So right now, I think we are focusing on our oral solids product portfolio, what we have, and we have enough products in the pipeline, which will take us to for next 2 to 3 years.
Okay, that's it from my side. Thank you.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, that was the last question for today. A request to the participants. If any questions are unanswered, you may please send the same to the investor relations desk. I would now like to hand the conference back to Mr. Yogesh Agarwal for closing comments. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, everyone, for joining this call. All I would say is please stay safe and take care of all your near ones and loved ones. In case there are any questions that remain unanswered today, you can reach to our investor relations team. Thank you.
Thank you. On behalf of Ajanta Pharma Limited, we conclude today's conference. Thank you all for joining. You may now disconnect your lines.
Thank you.